and welcome to Bethel Cumberland Presbyterian Church. It is January 10th. Glad to have you with us this morning. All of our musicians are preparing for the 24th of January when we will go back to in-person worship. And so they're preparing and they're not here this morning. So I called my friend, Alan Jackson, and I said, Alan, can you provide a little bit of music for us? And he said, well, sure. So that's what we started with this morning, and he's going to close us out also today. But I want to start this morning by making sure that everyone is aware that the elders have decided that we need to go back to in-person worship, and we're going to begin that on Sunday morning, the 24th of January. We will ask everyone, as we did last time, to enter through the fellowship hall to make sure that you sanitize your hands, have your mask on, pull it up over your nose, and other precautions necessary to keep everyone safe. And I am going to e-blast those lists of safety protocols out to everyone also. Let's begin this morning by praying together as we have been taught. This will bring us together. It will set the tone for the morning. And let us do that at this time, praying as Jesus has shown us the way. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The scripture that I have selected for today is from the book of John. And I have to put my glasses on because the print is kind of small this morning in this particular Bible and this version. This is actually the Holcomb Christian Study Bible version of the scripture. And this is from the book of John. And John is, in the beginning, is talking about why it is that Christ came. Why it is that God sent Jesus to us. And this is what John says in chapter 1, starting with verse 10. Jesus was in the world. It was the world that he created. And yet this world did not recognize him. He came to his own people, and they did not recognize him or receive him. But to all who did receive him, all who believed, he gave them the right to be children of their heavenly Father, to those who believe in Jesus' name. Those who were born not of the blood, nor of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of the will and spirit of God. The word of God became the flesh of Jesus the Messiah, and took up residence, lived among us here on this earth. And we could observe his glory, and we saw the grace of God through Jesus. And we heard the truth from his son Jesus. No one has ever seen God. The one and only Son, however, the one who is at the right hand of the Father, his son Jesus, has revealed God and his nature to us. This is the reading of God's word, and I ask that he add his blessing to our hearing of this word. Well, this is an interesting question for us to address in the really the first Sunday after we have completed our study of the Christmas story, the birth of Jesus Christ through the coming of the wise men and the visit of Jesus to the temple as a baby when he was presented, and then when he visited at 12 years old and he was instructing and questioning the leaders, the priests, the rabbi. Well, I have entitled today's message, "What Are You Gonna Do?" Now, I know that's bad English, and I probably shouldn't use it in case the children are listening. And I kind of got that from Jeff Foxworthy, who one of his most famous lines is when he was talking about how Southern people tend to take words and sentences and put them together and shorten them. The most famous one being "yuntu," which is Southern for "do you want to?" Yuntu? Go to the mall. Yuntu? Go out and eat. Well, today, what are you gonna do? It's the title of the message. And when I ask that question, I mean, what are you gonna do with Jesus now that you have Jesus? And we do have Jesus. Well, I looked something up, a list. I was looking for pieces of scripture that quoted Jesus as saying, "I have come to," and then whatever it was that Jesus said about his presence among the people. And I found a couple of theologians who took the scriptures and they came up with what they called 31 reasons why Christ came. Now, the first thing we need to understand about Christ coming to earth is this word incarnation, because we get confused sometimes, and we take the Holy Trinity, which is one, and we separate it because it's easier for us to get our human minds around the idea of three separate entities, which they are three separate entities. But at the same time, when it says God incarnate, that simply means God in the flesh. God decided at that point in history that he needed to come to teach the people, to walk among the people. And Jesus is the incarnation, God, God in the flesh, Jesus the Christ. So we have to bear in mind that not only was Jesus here as a human being, as a man, but he was also here as the presence of God, God incarnate among his creation. So the 31 reasons that these two theologians came up with are interesting, and we're going to look at those real quick and spend a little bit of time on them, and then I want to address the issue of what do you do with Jesus now that he has come and now that we have heard these 31 reasons why Christ came. They say that number one, and every single one of these is based on scripture, not their interpretation of the big picture, but a particular piece of scripture. The first one is to do the will of the Father. And we hear Jesus say this all the time. It is not my will that is being fulfilled. It is not my answer to you. It is the will of the Father that I do. I am obedient to God. That's why he came, one of the reasons, according to these two theologians, that he came to demonstrate for us that it is possible to live on this earth under these conditions and always do the will of the Father. He never left that pathway at all. His answer always was based on the Word of God and the Scriptures and what he understood or knew to be the will of the Father for all of his people. So that was number one. Jesus came to do the will of his Father. And he did. He was obedient to the nth degree. And then number two is one that we have heard since our childhood in Bible study and vacation Bible school and Sunday school, and that's simply to save sinners. Now, we Christians really latch on to this, and with good reason, because we understand the idea of human nature versus God's nature. And C.S. Lewis writes on this extensively, the idea that we are so subject, the idea of temptation, we are so subject to our human nature, those hormones and all of those things that run through us and the temptation of Satan placed before us and the easy path versus the path that sometimes God lays before us, and that we cannot under any circumstances, no matter how good we think that we are, can we save ourselves. And so these theologians say, according to the Scripture, and they quote 1 Timothy and they quote Hebrews for this, there's many, many other places to quote it, but Jesus came to save sinners because sinners cannot, under any circumstances, save themselves. And we understand that. So that's number two. And there are 31. Number three is to bring light to a dark world. Now, this is part of the introduction of the book of John, written by John, the idea that Jesus is the light of the world. And as a matter of fact, in Jesus, in his testimony before the people about who he is, the book of John has several quotations from Jesus in which he says, I am thee, and one of the most famous is that I am the light of the world. It's the understanding that we as Christians have that the world is a dark place. And Jesus says men like darkness so they can hide their evil thoughts and their evil actions, and they run from the light. And yet Jesus describes himself as the light of the world. The light that comes into the world that pushes back that darkness, pushes it away from us. Light that will dispel the myths, the evil, those dark corners that exist in this world. Jesus came to shed light in the darkness of this world. Then number four says, to be made like his people. Jesus came to be like his people. Now, this is a very important theological point, because some people, being human and falling prey to their human nature, they think that God in heaven, being God, and Jesus being the Son of God, cannot relate to who we are as human beings and our frailties, and our temptations, and the pain that we sometimes feel. And yet we know from the Scriptures that God sent Jesus as a human being into this world so he would know exactly what it means to be a human, exactly what it means to be faced with temptation, exactly what it means to have the pain of this world fall upon him. No one can deny that Jesus went through much pain, emotional and physical, in his life. So these theologians are correct. Jesus came to show us that he's like us, and only he can understand us. in all that we go through because he's been here and he has seen it and he has dealt with it. He cannot be accused of being above the pain of this earth, being above the temptations that Satan places before us, because he has been there. As a matter of fact, in the first of the Gospel of Luke, it talks about the temptation of Jesus. For 40 days, he was in the desert, and Satan chased him all over the place with temptations placed before him. Number five, they say, is to bear witness to the truth. You know, if there's one thing that human beings are really good at, is avoiding the truth and not telling the truth. You notice I didn't say we're a bunch of liars, but we're awful good at it. And I like to look at it from the perspective, not that we purposefully and intentionally lie about things, but we have trouble dealing with the truth. We lie to ourselves, we lie to God, we lie to one another, all in the avoidance of appearing to be a sinner. But Jesus bears witness to the truth of God. There is only one truth in the entire world, and that is the truth of God according to the words of Jesus Christ. Now, I understand there's lots of truth contained in the Old Testament. But it is the truth of Jesus Christ. He is bearing witness to the truth of God. He is the vessel that takes the word of God and gives it to us. He is the instrument of God that reveals the truth to us. The new covenant is part of that truth. I'm going to tell you the truth about God. I'm going to tell you the truth about yourself. That's called bearing witness, challenging people, laying the truth on them to see what they would do with it. Jesus bearing witness to the truth. And then they list one that I find is quite interesting because some people deny this. Number six, they say Jesus came to destroy the devil and his work. Now, they have several pieces of scripture that very pointedly illustrate, even according to the words of Jesus himself, that he has come to confront Satan and to destroy Satan and his influence in this world. Now, the ultimate destroying of Satan by Jesus Christ, of course, is when he is raised from the dead. And he passes that honor on to us. He conquers death. He conquers the power of Satan controlling death and controlling our destiny by the resurrection and giving to us control over death. All we do is proclaim Jesus Christ as our Savior, and we have destroyed Satan. We have destroyed his effect on our eternity and even in our day-to-day lives. Jesus illustrated for us when he spoke these words, "Get thee behind me, Satan." I can tell you for certain that if Satan is trying to influence your life, all you've got to do is stop and use those words. Get thee behind me, Satan. I recognize you. I know what you're trying to do, and I'm not going to allow it to happen. I belong to Jesus Christ, and you cannot win. Your temptation has no effect on me. So the truth of Jesus coming to destroy Satan and his effect on us day to day and eternally is absolutely and completely true. And then some of these, they kind of expand on just a little bit. Number seven is to give eternal life. Well, that's understood. That's part of the salvation story that we have. But number nine, I really like, and I'm going to expound on it a little bit later, and that's to bring great joy. Do you remember what the angels told the shepherds? We're here to give you some good news of great joy to all the people. That was one of the purposes of Jesus coming. And those people who received, according to the scripture of John, Jesus, and they recognized who he was, joy did enter their life at that moment. Yes, they still had times of sadness, as Jesus did in his life. But it's not happiness that we're supposed to be seeking, it's joy that we are supposed to be seeking. And joy is a spiritual thing. Either someone has a joyful spirit or they don't have a joyful spirit. Just because someone is happy or appears to be happy or glad has nothing to do with having a joyful spirit. That means in my innermost parts, Jesus dwells and I feel his joy. And we'll expound on that in just a bit. The next one that they have, number 10, is to demonstrate humility. And Jesus demonstrated humility by rejecting the boundaries and the things in this life that people think are important. Never had a house, you know, never had any place that he could call his own. He was a wanderer. He was a nomad. And he humbled himself. The most fine example we can get of humility in all of history is when Jesus obeyed his heavenly Father and humbled himself before God and said, yes, I'm going to obey you. Yes, I will humble myself before my heavenly Father. I will humble myself before all of these people, and I will offer myself up as a human sacrifice, as the Lamb of God to save all these people. He did that in humility. If he was a narcissistic, glory-seeking individual, he would not have done that. But he did do that. He humbled himself before people who were not worthy to be humbled before for their salvation. Then number 11, they said, Jesus came to preach the gospel. And he did. You know, I take great glory personally in reading the parables. I love a good story. I love symbolism. I still remember in school when some of the other kids were struggling with the idea of symbolism. Well, I thought, I got it. I thought, well, this is great. It's a story about this, but it means that. And we take great joy in reading those parables and listening to Jesus talk to the people. But when he says that he came to preach the gospel, that means he came to tell the poor, the disenfranchised, the marginal people, all of those people who had no good news in their life. He came to tell them the good news of salvation. That their life right now may be hard, may be difficult, but join my forces, get on my team. Come closer to God and you will find that joy. And when you leave this life behind you, you will be in a place of such massive and incredible joy that everything will fall away and be pale in comparison to that. Preaching the gospel. The word gospel means good news. I'm here to give good news. That's why every single week, no matter what the scripture, no matter what the message, I try to bring it back to the idea that in this scripture there is good news. I know, and I'm not particularly stealing this from Billy Graham, but that was one of his mantras. Always good news. Always tell the people the gospel. Always tell the people the good news. That God loves them, that they can have Jesus, that they can be saved, that their life can change today. Preaching the gospel, that's what Jesus did. He did not go into the palaces and preach to the courts of the kings and the queens and all that. He preached to the poor and the marginalized, the exploited, and all of those people, because he wanted them to have the good news. Now there's another side to this story. And these theologians zero right in at number 12 is to bring judgment. And Jesus says very clearly, whether you like it or not, whether you're one of those Christians that wants to talk about judgment and that final judgment placed upon all of us or not, Jesus came because God has placed upon his shoulders the responsibility, the obligation to judge. To judge the people as to whether or not they have accepted the good news from their Heavenly Father or they have rejected the good news from their Heavenly Father. It's a difficult concept for some people to understand because many of us of a little bit of age to us, we've always heard judgment explained as God will judge you. There will be a day of judgment. It's kind of like that hellfire and brimstone stuff. But the true meaning of judgment is that Jesus will just reveal to us, you rejected me. You rejected God. You rejected the good news. And therefore, I place no judgment on you, but you have judged yourself and placed yourself in this position. And yet, Jesus has that responsibility to explain to people where they fall short. Jesus has also come, and this is an important concept. Many modern Christians don't talk about this. He came to fulfill the law and the prophets. Over and over and over, Jesus quotes two things. Go back to the temptation of Jesus once again, those 40 days in the desert with Satan. And every single time that Satan approached him and tried to tempt him with something, he would quote the law and he would quote the prophets from the Old Testament. You can't deny it. The power of the law and the power of the prophets is overwhelming. And Jesus is the fulfillment of that. It's kind of like if you had two handfuls of the law and the prophets, and you brought them together, and somehow you could form them into a little ball, into something that was manageable and could be held in the palm of your hand. That's Jesus. He's the fulfillment of the law and of the prophets. And this is another point that these theologians make. They call it number 15. To reveal God's love to the sinners. Once again, for some Christians, it's a difficult concept because they don't think that their life is fulfilled enough or enriched enough or good enough or whatever you want to call it, and they don't think that they're feeling God's love. God loves all people. And the magic word there is all. This is revealed in the book of Luke and the book of John in particular. But for all people, God extends his hand of welcome and love. He loves you just like you are, asking you to come to him and be transformed. But it is his love that brings you near. It's kind of like the modern message to the people who go into the missionary field is to love and serve the people where they are. Don't judge them. Don't try and change them. Show them the love of God and they will come around. And that is God's hope, is that when he reveals how much he loves you, no matter what you've done, he says it himself. All things are forgivable by our Heavenly Father, except blaspheming against the Holy Spirit, according to Jesus Christ. No matter what you've done, God will forgive you. God will love you. He does ask us, according to these theologians, number 16, he does ask us, Jesus came to tell us. John the Baptist opened this door. Jesus explained it. We are being called by Jesus. Jesus came to tell us, you must repent of where you are and you must change. Does that mean you have to be perfect? No. Some people stumble over that stone all the time. You don't have to be perfect, but you do have to change. You do have to make the effort to come closer to the Lord. And we're going to talk about this next one in just a bit. It's called to serve. Jesus said, as he washed his disciples' feet, he said, I have not come to be served, but to serve. And I will serve others as part of my ministry. And he did that to show his disciples that, we're going to talk about this further in a bit, that's what you're supposed to do. That's what I'm demonstrating for you. I have come to serve, and I expect you also to serve those people. I really like number 22, to bind up broken hearts. Have any of you ever known a single human being who has never had their hearts broken? They've never been emotionally crushed. Jesus came for those people. Jesus came for those moments. When you are feeling completely broken and in the midst of despair that you think you cannot break the bonds of, Jesus is there to help bind up that broken heart, that broken spirit. The way we put it, for Jesus to make you whole once again. People with broken spirits and broken hearts, well, they feel like things are falling apart. And this is a great line, to bind them back together into a whole person. That's what Jesus came for. Jesus came to reign as king. Now, we have to be careful with that, because our image of kings from the Old Testament, from history in general of the world, is not really a good one. How many good kings that were interested in building roads, schools, hospitals, and feeding the people were there? I don't know. I can't even count enough to get up to, you know, five on this hand. But Jesus is king of his own kingdom. You may recall, he told Pilate, my kingdom is not of this world. I will not have territory. I will not have people serving me. My king is called the kingdom of God. I am a king of that. Because that is the kingdom as is willed by my Heavenly Father. He came to help us fight human nature. He came to show us about mercy and how to be faithful and obedient to our Heavenly Father. He came to be the second and greater Adam. Theologians like to draw this picture. They put Adam over here at the beginning, and they put Jesus over here at the end. Adam disobeyed God. Adam led us to a place of eternal death and separation from God. And Jesus is the second Adam, and he leads us back to God and glorious eternal life. He came to do that, to offset Adam and his effect on people and human nature. One of the things that they list reminds us of the story of the Samaritan woman at the well. They say, Jesus came to satisfy the thirst, eternal thirst, emotional thirst, spiritual thirst of the people. Do you remember what he told the Samaritan woman? He said, I give you water, and when you drink it, you will never thirst again. Of course, she did not understand. We have the advantage of history on our side and time to understand that, yes, he meant exactly what he said. I will give you, and he said this also in Jerusalem at one of the Passover celebrations in preaching to the people, come to me, I will give you the water that will satisfy you forever. And the final two that he has, one is called to be loved by God's children. You know, we don't have that perspective very often, but think about this. Jesus came so that we would love him, so that we would love God, so that we would come closer to the Holy Spirit. It's that Trinity thing again. But Jesus came to be loved. Well, we're going to talk about that in just a minute. And the final one that they have is to reveal God's glory. And he did that through all of his teaching and preaching and healing and all of everything that he did during his ministry. It revealed how glorious God really is to his people. Well, that begs the question, and that's where we're headed. I said at the beginning, you know, the story is going to be, what are you going to do? And that's the question now. You've heard all of these reasons, and you heard the scripture that describes why Jesus came. So now you must answer the question, not to me, but for yourself, what are you going to do? Now that you have Jesus, and you do have Jesus, what are you going to do with Jesus? Well, you know, I tried to come up with an adequate illustration to this and answering that question of what are you going to do. And I know in life that I was reminded immediately, I thought about that crazy Christmas movie called A Christmas Story where the guy gets the leg lamp. And it comes in the crate and he takes it out of the crate. And his wife looks at him like he's crazy, which he was. And it was a leg lamp and she said, well, now that you've got it, what are you going to do with that? Well, he put it in the front window of their house, which really didn't go over very well. And, you know, we have people, I've talked to them, and they admit it to me. No names involved here. They love to go to yard sales. And you know what they buy at yard sales? Stuff that when they get home, their spouse says, well, now that you've got that, what are you going to do with it? Probably put it on a shelf in the garage or in the attic. And men are particularly bad about this, bringing things home. It's a funny part of many movies from the 50s, especially of men going fishing or going hunting and showing up at the end of the day or the end of the weekend with a bunch of fish or maybe a bunch of squirrels or rabbits or something. And the wife goes, okay, now that you're here with all of this, what are you going to do with it? Because I'm not going to do anything with it. I don't want those dead squirrels or fish in my kitchen. Life asks us the question all the time, what are you going to do? Well, I have some suggestions for you of what you can do or what you should do with your Jesus. First, from the scripture that we read tonight, we are implored by John first to recognize Jesus. That's the first thing you do with Jesus, is you recognize who he is. And after you recognize who he is, the second step of that is to receive Jesus. Jesus is the creator. He's God in the flesh. He's the source of our grace. Free grace. He is the revealer of the true nature of God. You know, I talk about the God of the Old Testament, and the Hebrew and Jewish people try to make him out as this war God guy, and Jesus came in and revealed him as the God of love. So we have to, with our Jesus that we have, now that we have him, first thing we have to recognize him for who he is, and we have to receive him. And then from the list of 31, we get clues also of what we should do, what we should do with Jesus. I suggest you let Jesus be your flashlight in life. We all have dark recesses and dark corners, dark people who are not living, and I don't mean the color of their skin, people who live in darkness, who seem to like that, and we need a flashlight to help them see the truth and to help keep us from stumbling in the darkness. And that's Jesus. Let him be your flashlight to reveal the corners of darkness in your life. Jesus is the best defense we've got against Satan and his effect on our lives. I think you, the next thing you should do with Jesus is let him be your source of joy. You know, we all have crosses to bear. Jesus said, you will have crosses to bear. And when it comes to the point that we cannot bear anything else, we can't do, we think that we can't take anymore. That's when I turn to Jesus. Because he will give me inner joy, regardless of what may be going on in my life. The other thing that you need to do with Jesus, now that you have him and you understand him and you know why he came, is follow his example of service. Jesus said he came to serve, and therefore, you must serve. You must serve a church, your church, the church. You must serve the kingdom, God's kingdom. And you must serve the needy, those people around us that need things that we can give to them. I can say unequivocally, with the power and the words of Jesus backing me up, that you cannot be a Christian without getting in the trenches with Jesus and those people that need to be served. That's where Jesus is, and he wants you there with him. If you're not serving your church, if you're not serving the kingdom of God, if you're not serving that other person that needs your help, you can't really lay claim to the title of Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ. And then finally, and this was number 30 on their list, and I liked it best of all. It said, Jesus came to be loved. And that's my final instruction to you this morning, is to simply, and this is simple, simply love Jesus. You may or may not recall when you first fell in love with your significant other and how it just washed over you and how you could not escape those feelings that you had, that the love defined everything. And that's how I want you to be with Jesus. I want you to love Jesus, to return to him the love that he gives to you. If you can do that, if you've recognized Jesus, if you receive Jesus into your life, and you can love him, life will be grand for you. I promise it. Jesus promises it. It's a great line. Jesus came so that people would love him. And by loving Jesus, he made this clear, by loving Jesus, we're showing our love for Almighty God. He said it's the same thing. Love me, love God. Hate me, hate God. So that's the bottom line in the scripture. In the 31 reasons that Jesus came, is Jesus wants us to love him. And I do, and I hope that you do also. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we have been through the season of Christmas. We've looked at pictures of baby Jesus. We've gotten those beautiful Christmas cards with Christmas trees and manger scenes and snow, and it just lifts us up over and over. And now it is time. We must examine what it all means and answer that question, each in their own way, to their own heart, and to you, Heavenly Father, what are they going to do with baby Jesus now that they have him? I ask that you be with them during this time of discernment to help them to understand how important this question is, and how much more important the answer is. I ask all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, whom I love. Amen. We're going to close this morning. My friend Alan Jackson is going to sing for us Standing on the Promises. So let's enjoy that, and then I will give you a closing benediction. Receive this benediction. This morning, I want you to go forth knowing that the promises of God are real. Love his Son Jesus and live the promises. Amen. Thank you for being with us this morning.